Soundings Audiobooks present an unabridged recording of Walking by Night, written by Kate Ellis, read by Gordon Griffin. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Soundings, Whitley Bay, NE26, 2JT. Chapter 1. Debbie Telehay's footsteps echoed in the fog like hammer blows as her tottering heels hit the stone pavement. She shuddered, hugged the thin jacket she'd bought in the sales the previous Sunday around her body, and walked on, hurrying like a mouse who fears a cat is watching from the shadows. The city was shrouded in fog, milky white and yellow, where it blended with the sickly glow of the streetlights. She could only see 6 feet ahead, and every so often she heard voices that sounded as if they were coming from some distant world. Debbie hated fog. Fog conceals all kinds of wickedness. She'd had a good time at the Abbot's Head that evening. The music had been loud and the company raucous, up for anything. It had probably been a mistake to consume so many vodka shots, but she'd been caught up by the moment and the desire to follow her friend's example. They'd urged her on. Come on, let's have another. Let's get hammered. They'd been in a far worse state than she was, but they'd taken a minicab home. As she'd watched them clamber in, giggling, she'd wished she was with them. But they lived in the opposite direction, so there was no chance of her sharing the ride, and she had no money left for a cab of her own, because she'd put her last tenner into the kitty for the final round of drinks. She had to walk. There was no choice. She'd just reached the corner of Market Gate when she stumbled on her vertiginous heels. She carried on walking, but by the time she reached the main road, her ankle had started to throb, so she stopped. As she came to a halt, she heard a soft footstep echoing the sharp click of her stilettos. She turned her head, but when she saw nothing behind the blanket of mist, she told herself that it had probably been her imagination, and limped on. He'd been watching her all night, sitting in the corner of the bar at the Abbot's Head, while she laughed with her friends. He'd heard their chatter growing louder with each drink they'd downed, and they had downed a lot over the course of the evening. He'd been trying to make his pint last, because he wanted to keep a clear head. And when she'd stood up to leave, he drained the glass and followed her, careful to keep his distance. He'd seen her friends get into the minicab, while she set off home alone, vulnerable. Some things were meant to be. Debbie crossed the road to the museum gardens, trying to ignore the pain in her ankle. And she felt her heart thumping as she braced herself to flee if she saw some silent vehicle bearing down on her. But the street was empty of traffic. Nobody in their right mind would drive on a night like this. She turned right and walked parallel with the railings, putting out a cold hand that touched them and finding the solid feel of the metal reassuring. The fog was denser now, and fear of getting lost in its enveloping embrace crept into her mind like mist seeping through an open window. Her heels were slowing her down, and her ankle was getting worse. She stopped to take off her shoes, feeling a sudden urge to run for home and flee this unearthly landscape, where the familiar had turned frighteningly unfamiliar. But she wondered whether home was any safer, now that her mother had moved Sinclair in. He made her flesh creep. But her mother didn't see it. She'd let him into her life because she feared being alone. There's none so blind as the desperate. As she bent to slip off her shiny beige stilettos, she heard the sound again. Footsteps that stopped a few seconds after hers, like a delayed echo. She was scared now. So scared that she ignored the pain when her unprotected feet met a patch of gravel. Someone had stopped when she had stopped. Someone was out there in that dense wall of mist, following her, watching each move she made and assessing her vulnerability. She saw Eborby's main library looming up on her left, and she knew it wasn't far to the Undercroft, the only part of the medieval monastery of St. Peter still standing after centuries of destruction and neglect. In its sheltering covered passageway, lovers met, and tourists wandered. But at this time, the night people took over, the drug dealers and the up-to-no-good hangers-about. But if she could slip inside and wait till her pursuer had passed, she might throw him off. To her vodka-fuddled brain, it seemed like the perfect solution to her problem. She limped into the Undercroft's dank passageway on tiptoe, her shoes dangling from her left hand and the cold numbing her feet. And to her surprise and relief, the place was empty. As she flattened herself against the wall, her fingers came into contact with something soft and damp, moss, which felt like dead men's flesh. She breathed in deeply, and when the chill, moist air hit her lungs, she started to splutter, the noise sounding like gunshots in the silence. She covered her mouth with her free hand and waited, half expecting to see a figure looming at the end of the passageway. But nothing happened. Perhaps the footsteps had been in her imagination, or a trick of the fog. Both ends of the tunnel-like undercroft were blocked by a wall of grey-white mist. But even in the darkness, she could make out the shape of a huge stone Roman sarcophagus which stood against the stone wall, its mass looking vaguely industrial against the barrier of fog. As her eyes grew accustomed to the gloom, she opened the little denim bag she'd slung across her body to foil any passing muggers, and inside it, her fingers came into contact with the comforting shape of her mobile phone. But who could she call? Not her mother. Telling her mother would be like telling Sinclair, and that was a prospect she couldn't face. Not the friends who'd abandoned her so blithely. Calling the police would be an overreaction, and she'd probably be charged with wasting their time. She felt tears welling in her eyes and a warm trickle of moisture running down her cheek. She'd read about people who died of exposure. But was being attacked, maybe raped and strangled, any better? If she waited another 5 minutes, she reckoned it would be safe to leave her shelter. Hopefully, he'd think he'd lost her and give up, turn his evil attention to some other unsuspecting girl on her way home after a night out. She crept further into the tunnel, fingering the phone that could be her lifeline if events took a turn for the worse. Her ankle was aching now, and she was as sure as she could be that it was swollen. As she bent to rub it, her eyes were drawn to something lying on the ground near the other end of the passage, outlined against the ghostly light seeping in through the far entrance. At first, it looked like a bundle of old clothes that someone had discarded, and she stared at it for a while, before curiosity made her take a few halting steps towards it, glancing behind her to make sure her follower hadn't appeared, looming against the fog. As her courage grew, she took another step, then another, gasping as her bare foot came into contact with a tiny stone. There was no sound in the blanketed silence, apart from her own breathing. She was alone with the thing on the ground. And when she heard a soft sigh, she didn't know whether she'd made the sound, or whether it came from someone or something else. The thing on the ground, perhaps. As she drew closer, she thought the shape looked human, but it was too dark to be sure. Someone asleep, maybe. A vagrant, sleeping rough. As her eyes adjusted, she thought she could make out long, dark hair falling like a mask where the face should be. And clothes. Something long and dark, which showed no flesh. She suspected it was a woman, but she couldn't bring herself to touch her. To feel cold cloth wrapped around dead flesh, because her senses told her that this woman had become a corpse, a still, cold cadaver, and the sigh had come from somewhere else, perhaps whoever had ended the woman's life. She looked round, fighting the panic that had started to overwhelm her, and out of the corner of her eye she caught sight of a shape, half-formed in the swirling mist. It looked like a figure in long black robes. A thing with no face, there for a split second before the fog reformed itself into a white wall, and then it was gone, leaving only fear behind. She let out an involuntary scream and clamped her hand over her mouth. If it was a killer, The last thing she wanted was to draw attention to herself. But nothing happened. She told herself she must have imagined the figure. But those following footsteps, and the body lying there on the ground, were all too real. Terror made her forget her pain. As she tore through the Undercroft entrance and out into the fog, she opened her mouth to shout for help, but thought better of it. Instead, she fumbled for her phone with clumsy, panicked fingers, and when she dropped it, she squatted down and felt around for it in the shadows. There was no sign of the phone. But she needed to get away, so she abandoned her search and ran out, hardly aware that one of her shoes had slipped from her hand. It wasn't far to the centre of the city, and the pubs would be throwing out now. There was safety in crowds, and she could summon help. As she crossed the road by the art gallery, she narrowly avoided a bus that was driving too fast for the lack of visibility, but panic blinded her to danger as Boothgate Bar reared up in front of her out of the fog. She knew there was a pub at the other side of the city gate. If she could get there, everything would be fine. She staggered under the great stone gate, ignoring a small group of jeering men, relieving themselves in the shelter of the archway, and spotted the welcoming golden glow from the mitre's leaded windows to her left. She stumbled in through the open door, and when she screamed, the bar fell silent. He knew she hadn't seen him. How could she? But something had spooked her. She tried to hide from him in the Undercroft, thinking he'd be fooled. With all that drink, she hadn't been thinking straight, and her fuddled brain had underestimated him. She'd almost made it too easy for him, until she'd torn out of there and made for the city centre. But there'd be another time. He could find her whenever he wanted. Chapter 2. Over the years, Joe Plantagenet had become used to drinking alone, to sitting in the corner watching his fellow drinkers and imagining their lives. The passivity of enjoying a quiet pint of black sheep made a welcome change from police work. In his local, he didn't have to solve anybody's problems. He looked at his watch. It was time to go. If he had any more, he'd wake up with a hangover and be plagued with a headache all day, which was the last thing he needed. Besides, he'd promised his boss, DCI Emily Thwaite, that he'd be at the police station early, because she had a meeting with the superintendent, and she needed him to deal with the morning briefing. He drained his glass and stood up. He took his glass back to the bar, earning himself a nod of thanks from the landlord. Then he zipped his leather jacket and walked out into the night. The fog outside hit his lungs as soon as he stepped out of the pub doorway, and he began to cough. Eborby was prone to fog. Always had been since the Roman invaders decided it was the perfect location for their military headquarters in the north of England. He wondered what those soldiers from Italy and the warmer parts of the Empire had made of the Yorkshire weather. Probably not a lot. The wall of white cloud was so thick this time that a stranger to the city would have had difficulty finding their way around. But this was terra cognita to Joe. He could find his way back home to his flat in the shadow of the city walls, blindfold. It had been built in the 1990s, but he'd always felt that the proximity of history more than made up for the soulless architecture. Fog plays strange tricks with sounds, and the shouts and screams seemed to be feet away. Without a second thought, he moved towards the sounds. Even off duty, his policeman's instincts drew him to trouble. After a few moments, he realised that the noise was coming from a pub a few doors down the street. From the Mitre, a cosy place he'd almost chosen for his evening drink. But when he'd poked his head round the door, he'd found that his favourite corner had been taken, so he'd walked down to the cathedral vault instead. The entrance to the Mitre stood out, bright and welcoming in the mist. But Joe knew from the sounds drifting out of the pub that something was amiss. His first assumption was that there'd been some kind of drunken altercation, although the Mitre's landlord, in Joe's experience, ran a tight and law-abiding operation. But it was a female voice that rose above the rest, terrified and close to hysteria. Joe straightened his back and strode into the pub. Inside, the drinkers, a mixture of regulars he'd recognised and tourists in search of Eborby's quieter nightlife, sat staring at the main event. A motherly barmaid and the landlord ministering to a girl who was sitting between them on a bar stool with a glass of something comforting in her shaking hand. "What's happened? Is she okay?" Joe asked as he approached the little group. The landlord, a small, wiry man with a hairstyle that reminded Joe of a monk's tonsure, turned towards Joe, a what's-it-to-you expression on his round face. Joe, realising that although he'd been in there countless times, the landlord had no idea what he did for a living, pulled his warrant card from his pocket and showed it discreetly to the man. The landlord's attitude changed in an instant. He looked round the bar and lowered his voice. "She came in here as if the devil himself was after her. She says she's found a body. My wife's already called your lot, but they've not arrived yet. That was over 10 minutes ago," he added reproachfully. Joe squatted down and brought his face level to the girl's. She was in her late teens, he guessed, slightly overweight, with long brown hair that had frizzed in the damp air. She had a small nose and a rosebud mouth, and she looked a wreck. Her thick makeup had smeared, leaving dark tracks of eyeliner and mascara running down her cheeks. Her clothes, inadequate for the chill of the night, had bunched up, showing a long expanse of thigh. Her tights were intact up to her ankles, but her feet were torn, revealing filthy, bleeding flesh beneath. A single beige stiletto lay discarded on the floor. "Hi, love. My name's Joe. I'm a policeman. What's your name?" She took a deep, shuddering breath. "Debbie. Debbie Teller, hey?" She sipped her drink, and Joe saw her hand was still trembling. "Debbie, can you tell me what happened?" It took a few moments for the answer to come. I went for a drink with my mates in the Abbot's Head, and while I was walking home, I got the feeling I was being followed." She paused to take another drink. "Anyway, I was so scared, so I nipped into the Undercroft. You know, the old building by the library."
"I know it. Go on."
"Well, I thought I'd shaken him off, and I was going to carry on walking home when—" She stopped speaking, as though what she was about to say was too painful to contemplate. Joe knew that if he tried to rush her, she'd clam up altogether. This needed patience. After a long silence, she began to whisper. "It was dark, and with the fog, I thought I saw something on the ground."
"What?"
"I thought it was a bundle of clothes at first, but then I saw it was a woman. I didn't touch her."
"So you don't know if she was dead or just unconscious?"
"I was sure she was dead, but—"
Her eyes met his.
"Do you think she might have been alive?"
Joe didn't answer. He didn't want to make the girl feel bad about fleeing the scene rather than calling an ambulance right away. He touched her hand, a gesture of reassurance, and retraced his steps to the doorway. Standing in the entrance, he took his mobile phone from his pocket to make the call that would, hopefully, hurry things along. Although on such a foggy night, the patrols on duty would undoubtedly have their hands full. He got through to the control room and explained who he was and what had happened. A couple of minutes later, he had a call from the patrol who just arrived at the Undercroft. They were about to conduct a search. Joe turned and went back into the pub. It was just a matter of waiting. Driving in such thick fog was bloody dangerous, Sergeant Una O'Kane observed to the young PC sitting, arms folded in the passenger seat. She'd seen countless nasty RTAs when people went too fast for the conditions. As she said the words, a van loomed in front of her, seemingly out of nowhere. She hit the brake pedal and swore loudly. When she reached their destination, she pulled the car off the road. It would be tempting fate to park on the road so that some idiot could cannon into them. Yuna had never had an optimistic view of human nature. They climbed out of the car, and Yuna's young colleague put on his cap. "Who reported it?" he asked. "Alas, on her way home for a night out, she thought she was being followed by some weirdo, so she hid in the undercroft in the hope he'd go past. Stupid thing to do if you ask me," she said with a snort. "What if he'd seen her go in? She'd have been cornered in there. At least out on the street, she'd have a fighting chance of someone passing by." "Did he corner her?" "No, but, well, I wouldn't have done it." "Of course you wouldn't, Sarge." He could have added that it would be a brave weirdo who'd follow Yuna O'Kane, but he was too scared. "Let's see the body, then. Shouldn't we call for backup? The pathologist, and let's see what we've got first. We don't want to call out the whole team only to find that it's only a drunk sleeping it off." Yuna went ahead, flashing her torch into the mouth of the undercroft. It lit up the rough stone walls and the vaulted ceiling of what had once served as a storage area for the long-destroyed abbey. As either end was open, it was little more than a passageway, joining the museum gardens to the library area. Yuna swept her torch over the ground and shook her head. If there'd been a body, it wasn't there now. Chapter 3 Joe was tempted to call the patrol to find out what was going on, but he stopped himself. They'd ring him as soon as there was news. Debbie had been taken into the back room behind the bar by the landlord's wife, a no-nonsense bottle blonde, who Joe sensed was beginning to lose patience with the girl, who'd consumed at least 3 double measures of liquid comfort since she set foot over the threshold. Joe had told her she should wait for the patrol to come and take a statement, but after half an hour he was becoming restless. The girl needed to get home. She told him she lived with her mum, so at least she'd have a shoulder to cry on when she got back. He'd already suggested that Debbie should call her mum, but she'd seemed reluctant, saying she'd be fine to get home by herself. The landlord's wife took the same size in shoes, and she'd lent her a pair of old and sensible loafers, so the walk wouldn't be a problem. Joe told her the patrol car would take her back, but this suggestion was met with a disapproving silence and a "no thanks." He wondered why she'd refused, and concluded that she might have had an unpleasant encounter with the police in the past. But he wasn't going to interrogate her. When the body was found, she'd have to answer plenty of questions, whether she liked it or not. He looked at his watch. It was almost midnight. The pub was empty and the staff wanted to go home. Joe was almost losing patience when his phone rang. The female voice on the other end of the line announced herself as Yuna O'Kane. "Sergeant." "No sign of a body here," she began. She sounded relieved. "No blood or drag marks either. Either the girl was seeing things after a night on the sauce, or she panicked when she saw some vagrant taking a nap. She seemed pretty sure it was... It could have been someone trying to scare her. Might have been some comedian's idea of a joke." If this was a joke, it wasn't funny, Joe thought. And Debbie certainly wasn't laughing. She still looked shaken, sitting staring at her hands as the landlord's wife tidied up around her. "Have you searched the area?" Joe asked. "Of course," the sergeant answered, as though the question had been a particularly stupid one. "There's nothing suspicious." "She said she dropped her phone there. Did you find it?" "Yes. I'll take it back to the station and she can pick it up in the morning. Why don't you tell her to go home and sober up?" Joe entered the call. And when he entered the back room, Debbie looked up expectantly. "That was the patrol. They found your phone, but there's no body in the undercroft." "Are you sure that's where you saw it?"
"Yes. I told you. I'm not lying,"
I saw it. There was no uncertainty in her voice.
Okay.
He raised his hand in appeasement. Let's get you home. It's on my way, so I'll walk with you. I can explain what happened to your mum if she's worried.
There's no need, she said,
with an anxiety which suggested to Joe that she found the prospect of a policeman talking to her mother more alarming than the ordeal of discovering a corpse. But he was probably wrong. The girl was exhausted. People say odd things when they're in that state.
You will let me walk with you. I don't like just leaving you.
She hesitated, but one look at the landlord's wife's impatient face decided her.
Okay.
She slipped on the old shoes. They fitted, but she shuffled out as though walking caused her pain. Joe wondered whether to support her arm, but he feared the gesture might be misinterpreted. In fact, he knew it was probably foolish to be alone with a vulnerable woman like that. But he'd done a lot of foolish things in his time, so what was one more? They walked slowly, and when their arms brushed by accident, Joe flinched at the contact.
What do you think you saw?
He said, when they reached the main road.
A body. I think she had long hair, and she was wearing something long and dark. A skirt or a coat. I couldn't see very well in that light.
Perhaps she wasn't dead. Perhaps she was drunk and she collapsed and then she came round and wandered off.
No, she was dead.
How could you tell?
I just could, she said, a note of impatience in her voice.
But if you didn't touch her...
She was definitely dead.
They'd reached Debbie's address. It wasn't far from Joe's flat, just over the main road that ran alongside the city walls and up a little street of Victorian terraced houses. She stopped at the front door and took her key from her bag.
I left my shoe in the pub. I dropped the other when I...
I can get it for you if you like, he said, thinking that one shoe wouldn't be much good.
No, it's okay. I'll have to take these back to the landlady's tomorrow and...
Well, the office there. And make sure you go to the station tomorrow to get your phone back.
Their eyes met, and she gave him a nervous half-smile. He watched as she fumbled to get the key in the lock. The house was in darkness. Nobody had waited up.
You sure you don't want me to?
No.
She lowered the key and turned to face him.
This sounds really stupid, but I think I saw a shape in the fog at the far end of the undercroft. I might have been imagining it, but...
Can you describe it?
Debbie hesitated, then gave a little laugh.
You're going to think I'm crazy.
Try me.
It looked like a nun.
Chapter 4. Joe had already given the morning briefing when DCI Emily Thwaite arrived in the CID office. The previous night, he'd feared that they might be starting a major murder investigation that morning, but, as it was, it had turned out to be a false alarm. However, as he'd been trying to get to sleep last night, some nagging voice in the back of his mind told him that once the fog had lifted and the daylight arrived, the body Debbie Teller Hay was convinced she saw might well turn up. But there'd been no call. They were off the hook. It was 9:30 when Emily bustled in. She had the harassed look of someone who'd just been landed with work they considered burdensome and unnecessary. She caught Joe's eye as she passed his glass-fronted office, and he stood up and followed her. She looked as if she wanted to talk, or at least to have someone to share her troubles with. Emily sat down as he entered her office. Hers was larger than his, with her name and rank inscribed on a brass plate on her door and blinds for privacy. Emily Thwaite's round face was what many would call pretty, framed by unruly fair curls. She was plump, forever on a diet of one description or another. In a moment of rash boldness, Joe had once told her to move more and eat less. She'd pretended she hadn't heard him.
"I believe that damsel in distress you rescued led us a merry dance last night," she said. "Think she was having you on?"
Joe shook his head.
"No, she was genuinely scared. Whatever she saw or imagined she saw terrified her."
He hesitated.
"She said it was a dead woman. Even described what she was wearing." "It must have been dark in there. How could she have seen anything?"
"She said there was enough light for her to make things out."
"And was there?"
Joe felt unsure of himself.
"I don't know. Once the patrol had given the all clear, I didn't think it necessary to go there and have a look. But there was a full moon behind all that fog and street lamps, so I suppose. If you ask me, she'd had too much to drink and started hallucinating."
She paused.
"I hear you walked her home."
"I didn't like to leave her to go home alone."
"You should have asked the patrol car to drop her off, if you were that worried."
"I suggested that, but she was quite adamant."
"Think she's got something against the police?"
The question was sharp. "Or her mother has."
"What was this girl's name again?"
"Debbie Tellahay." Emily frowned, as if she was trying to recall some elusive fact. Then a gleam of recognition appeared in her blue eyes.
"Tellahay? You sure?"
"Yeah.
Why?"
"Well, I was in Leeds. There was a case involving a family called Tellahay. The little boy, Peter, went missing and he was never found. The mother called in a medium, or rather the medium volunteered his services. Turned out to be as much good as a chocolate teapot. But the mother hung on his every word. Sad." She thought for a few moments.
"I seem to remember there was a sister. And I'm sure her name was Deborah. I think she was a couple of years older than the missing lad."
"When did all this happen?"
"It was around 10 years ago.
I was only a humble DC back then. And I was stuck in the incident room dealing with the routine stuff, so I didn't have much to do with the family, but I do remember our SIO moaning about this medium lurking about like a bad smell."
"Medium? As in seances?"
"Yes, or was he a psychic? Anyway, the mother became very dependent on him. He even started ignoring police advice."
"Debbie told me she lives with her mother. And her mother's partner. I got the impression that the partner was bad news.
I remember hearing that the Tellahays' marriage broke up under the strain of the kid going missing. It's sad, but it happens."
She paused. "You've got me intrigued now."
"How do you mean?"
"I'm curious to know how Debbie's turned out and how the mother's coping now. But I don't expect you'll be seeing her again."
"Unless they find the body she thinks she saw."
Emily looked Joe in the eye. "I worry about you sometimes, Joe. All this drinking alone."
Joe had been about to leave the office, but now he turned back to face her. "Nothing wrong with a quiet pint?"
He knew he sounded defensive, but that's how he felt. He sometimes wished that Emily would keep her interfering instincts for those who appreciated them. "And it's better than sitting watching bad cop shows in an empty flat."
Before Emily could reply, D.S. Sonny Porter poked his head round the door of Emily's office. He was a small, wiry man with a permanently glass-half-empty expression. The name bestowed on him by his optimistic parents was Samson, but years ago someone with a sense of humour had named him Sonny, a title he had never lived up to.
"Can I have a word, ma'am?"
"You can have as many as you like, Sonny. What's up?"
"A woman's been reported missing. She's only been gone since last night, but in view of that wild goose chase in the Undercroft..."
He glanced at Joe.
"An actress called Perdita Elmott, who's in the latest production at the Playhouse. She didn't return to her digs after the performance last night, and she hasn't turned up at the theatre for a rehearsal this morning."
"When was she last seen?" Joe asked.
"She told the girl she's sharing with that she was going for a drink with someone after last night's performance and said she'd be back before midnight."
She walked into the fog just after 10:30 and hasn't been seen since. I started worrying when she didn't arrive at this morning's rehearsal. Apparently, it was an important one. And she said she'd be there. She's normally pretty reliable. Do we have a description? Age 25, average height, long dark hair, slim. Last seen wearing an ankle-length black velvet coat over a long floral skirt. There's a photo of her up in the Playhouse foyer, apparently. I said we'd pick up a copy. Joe caught Emily's eye. What's on at the Playhouse? Emily asked. Sonny examined his notebook. It's something called the Devils. Apparently, there's a lot of nuns.
Debbie's head hurt, as though 1,000 small blacksmiths were going about their business in her brain. And she had a raging thirst, which made her down a large glass of tap water as soon as she crawled out of bed. When she opened the thin curtains of her tiny bedroom, she saw the fog had dispersed overnight, leaving a trace of mist lurking in the treetops. And the sun was shining behind a blanket of pale cloud, turning the sky a dazzling grey. The events of the previous night seemed unreal and distant now. The daylight had robbed her of last night's certainties. Had fear made her imagine that figure on the ground? She could no longer be sure. She thought of the policeman. He'd asked her to call him Joe. Had he been different somehow from the police officer she'd encountered in those terrible days when her family's world had shattered and her mother had surrendered to shadows and despair? Maybe she should try to see Joe again. He was older than she was, probably in his 30s, and he was good-looking with his blue eyes and his black hair, worn long enough to cover his ears. He had a generous mouth and freckles on his nose, and there was something about him that made you want to confide your innermost secrets. But she told herself that he was a policeman. They hadn't been much use before, so why should things change now? Nobody could protect her from Sinclair. He was too clever for that. She opened her bedroom door and looked up and down the landing, just to make sure Sinclair wasn't about. Once she was sure, she staggered to the bathroom, her arms full of clothes. The bathroom lock was broken, so Sinclair could walk in on her whenever he liked. But if she pushed the chair against the door, she was safe. He entered her bedroom whenever he thought he could get away with it, and when she'd mentioned it to her mother, she'd made some excuse for him, just as she always did. It was Saturday, so there was no college that morning, but she still wanted to get away from the house. She wanted to be anywhere she wouldn't have to see Sinclair. Now, fully dressed in jeans and sweatshirt, hair straightened, brushed and swept up into a ponytail, she crept downstairs, alert for any telltale signs of Sinclair's presence. When she entered the kitchen, she saw that it was tidy. Mum had cleared up after him. He wouldn't have done it himself. He never did. She switched the kettle on and took a tea bag from the canister before raiding the bread bin, relieved that he hadn't had the last of the loaf. Then she looked out of the window. His car was still there, the old BMW that had been resprayed egg yolk yellow at some time in its dodgy past. He was still around somewhere, lurking, watching, like he always did, his eyes stripping off her clothes, staring into her soul. As she dropped two slices of white bread into the toaster, she heard a noise behind her and swung round. He was standing in the doorway. 5'8", tattooed arms, short, red-tinged hair turning prematurely grey. His face was thin like a rat's, his eyes ice blue, and his lips turned up slightly at the corners in an expression of permanent amusement. He got away with so much, Debbie thought, because he made anyone who challenged him seem a foolish prig who couldn't take a joke. But there was nothing funny about him. She'd seen his dark side. She wasn't taken in.
"You got in late last night," he said,
walking towards her slowly. To a casual observer, the movement would have appeared harmless, relaxed. But she saw only menace in his approach. She turned to watch the toaster. Sometimes, if she ignored him, he got the message and went away. But today wasn't one of those days. He was standing close to her now, so close that she could feel his breath on her neck. She stepped to one side and turned to face him. "Where's Mum?"
"Gone to work." "It's just you and me," he said with a smirk.
"Was it you last night? Were you following me?" When he reached out a hand and pinched her cheek, she flinched at his touch.
"Why shouldn't I follow my favourite girl?" he said, in a suggestive whisper. And someone else was taking an interest too. I think you've got an admirer."
Debbie pushed past him and ran out of the kitchen. She'd rather go hungry. Chapter 5. The powers that be at Eborby's Playhouse Theatre liked to court controversy from time to time. And ever since the artistic director had watched Ken Russell's film version of The Devils, with a fascination verging on the prurient, she'd longed to include the play in the repertoire. So far, it seemed that the people of Eborby didn't share her enthusiasm for witchcraft, torture, exorcisms, and lustful, writhing nuns. But she hoped that word of mouth and favourable reviews would soon turn her production into a box office hit. Normally, the police would respond to such an early report of a missing, healthy, independent adult with bland reassurances, and the matter would be dealt with by uniform. But after Debbie Teller Hay's strange experience the previous night, and because of the fact that her description of the body she'd seen bore certain similarities to the missing actress, Perdita Elmert, Joe was eager to find out more. Emily thought he was overreacting, but she said she fancied a bit of fresh air after being cooped up in her office for days, so she'd go to the theatre with him. They decided to go on foot, as the playhouse wasn't far from police headquarters, and they walked side by side in silence. Since she'd questioned his nocturnal drinking habits earlier, she guarded her words carefully, in case she came across as interfering. However, that didn't mean she wasn't itching to meddle in his life, it was in her nature. But she knew it would erect a barrier between them if she made it too obvious, so she said nothing. It was Joe who spoke first.
"I was thinking of going to see this production."
"I thought it sounded a bit gruesome." Emily, who had to arrange babysitters for her three children whenever she ventured out at night, only tended to choose entertainment she was guaranteed to enjoy. Certainly, scenes of death and torture weren't on her list of things to see. She had enough of that sort of thing at work. They reached the theatre, a Victorian edifice with a modern glass frontage. The row of identical posters outside depicted a sea of twisted faces on a blood-red background with a crucifix superimposed on top. Joe glanced at the image and looked away.
"Appeals to you, does it? All this churchy stuff?"
"Not when it's done by people who know nothing about it," he said quickly. Emily could never forget that Joe had once trained to be a priest before he met a girl who made him rethink his plans for a life of celibacy. She didn't know why, but this part of Joe's life had always held a fascination for her, even though she'd never considered herself particularly religious, just the usual weddings, funerals, and Christmas sort of Anglican. Joe's story had stuck in her mind. How he'd married Caitlin, the girl who'd led him from the path of holiness. How she had died soon after their wedding in a tragic accident, a fall from a cliff path in Devon. Then, sometime later, Joe had joined the police, and he'd been shot and injured while on duty in his native Liverpool, and his close colleague had been killed. The bullet wound in his shoulder still gave him trouble from time to time, a niggling reminder of mortality. In an unguarded moment, she had once asked whether he feared that it had been some kind of punishment, regretting the words as soon as they'd left her lips. He told her it didn't work like that. But there'd been a lot of bad things in Joe Plantagenet's life, and since his girlfriend Maddie had moved down to London a couple of years ago, he lived alone, which Emily didn't think was healthy. But she tried to suppress her inner mother. Joe had to live his own life. I'm just remembering what Debbie Teller-Hay said when she found the body that wasn't there. She thought she saw a nun in the mist. Emily rolled her eyes. She'd had too much to drink. Nuns and bodies make a change from pink elephants, but you didn't see her, Emily. She was terrified. She ran through the streets barefoot. Her feet were bleeding. I acknowledge that something gave her a fright, but I draw the line at ghostly nuns. She noticed the cast photos arranged on the foyer wall and walked over to examine them. Which one's our missing actress? As was customary in theatres, the photographs of the cast were artistically posed professional efforts, enhanced to make the most of the performer's looks. Joe's eyes were drawn immediately to Perdita Elmet's. She had even, almost feline features, with lustrous dark hair that tumbled around her shoulders. The legend beneath the photograph told him that she was playing the part of Sister Jeanne of the Angels. Joe, not being familiar with the play or the film, wasn't sure how substantial the role was, but he assumed from the prominent position of the picture that Sister Jeanne must be an important character. An actor called Jonas Ventner reported her missing, said Emily. She pointed to a photograph of an earnest-looking young man, with the name printed underneath. He said he'd meet us here. Apparently, they're having some sort of rehearsal for the understudy at the moment in case Perdita doesn't turn up in time for tonight's performance. Could be someone's lucky break. Let's hope not, said Joe, suddenly serious. He couldn't get Debbie's description of the body she claimed to have found out of his head. The hair, the long dark coat. But when the patrol had gone to the undercroft, there'd been no body. Emily pushed open the swing door with the polished brass handles that led into the auditorium. Joe could hear voices coming from the direction of the stage, but they stopped as soon as Emily let the door swing back. A man and a woman stood in a well of bright light behind the proscenium arch. They turned and watched as Joe and Emily walked down the central aisle between the red plush seats, and once they were close to the stage, the man spoke. "Sorry, this is a private rehearsal." The words sounded peevish with a hint of self-importance. Joe took his warrant card from the pocket of his leather jacket and held it up like a charm to ward off evil. "Police. I'm looking for Jonas Ventner." "That's me," the man said meekly, a hint of nervousness in his voice. He was in his 20s, skinny, dark and intense. "You reported one of your colleagues missing." "That's right. Come round the side, I'll meet you." He turned to the woman. "Sorry, Charlotte, won't be long." He hurried off the stage, leaving the woman staring. She had long waves of golden brown hair and a face that, although not classically pretty, her nose being a little too long and her chin a little too prominent, was striking. She picked up her script and began to study it as Joe and Emily made their way to the door beside the stage. Once through the door, the theatrical opulence vanished. Backstage was strictly utilitarian and smelled of paint, and something else Joe didn't recognise. Jonas Ventner was waiting for them, his face solemn. He looked worried, but Joe recalled that he was an actor. Appearances might be deceptive. "Thanks for coming. We were just going over Perdita's scenes." He led the way into a shabby corridor, with doors either side. "Dressing rooms," Joe guessed. Jonas pushed one of the doors open, and Joe followed him inside. The dressing room was cluttered with makeup and cards from well-wishers, and a pile of paperback books, crime novels of the more lurid variety, stood in the corner of the long counter below an illuminated mirror. Costumes hung from hooks on the wall opposite the mirror. a priest's robes, then some kind of long gown, then more priest's robes, more tattered this time, then a torn and bloodied shift, the sort of victim of torture might be found in. These costumes, Joe imagined, charted the downfall of Jonas's character. He was suddenly intrigued and wanted to ask more. But that wasn't what they were there for. They were invited to sit on two sagging armchairs, while Jonas perched on a stool by the mirror. "Is there any news?" "I'm afraid not," said Emily, assuming her most sympathetic expression, the one she usually kept for breaking news of the unwelcome variety. "But you're obviously taking it seriously. I was expecting some uniformed constable or..." "You've found something, haven't you?"
"Not yet," said Joe,
suddenly feeling that the visit might have been a mistake. Apart from Debbie Teller Hay's bizarre statement, they had no idea what had become of Perdita Elmert. For all they knew, she might have decided to bail out of the production for reasons of her own. Perhaps when they questioned her fellow actors, they'd get a better idea. Joe let Emily ask the questions while he listened, taking notes occasionally. He watched Jonas's face. He seemed sincere enough, as he recounted how Perdita had behaved perfectly normally yesterday. The director had called a short rehearsal in the morning to iron out some glitches in Act One, and then they'd all gone their separate ways until the performance. Perdita had said she was going back to the flat off Boothgate she shared with Hen, who was playing the part of the young and vulnerable Philippe Tronquin, the daughter of a magistrate in the French town of Loudun, where most of the action took place. Jonas had spent the afternoon using the computer in the library to send emails, and then he and Hen had met for something to eat in the theatre café. Perdita had turned up slightly late for the half, the 30 minutes or so before curtain up, when all actors are expected to be in the theatre preparing for the performance, looking rather flushed. Then at the end of the play she shot off, saying she was meeting someone, and telling Hen not to put the latch on the flat door because she'd be in before midnight. She never came home, and she didn't turn up the next morning when the director, Louisa, was due to give some important notes. There had been no hint that anything was amiss at the previous night's performance.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.